This evening on The Rock Newman Show, just days after the Dallas police massacre and in light of recent shooting deaths of black men at the hands of police, we'll take a critical look at the case of Christopher Jeffries, a local man who recorded his controversial treatment by cops after a traffic stop. We are joined by Mr. Jeffries, his mother Christy Finner, and his attorney J. Wendell Gordon. Also with us is Tamara Meekins, D.C. Deputy Attorney General for Public Safety. That's coming up right now on The Rock Newman Show. Welcome to The Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. Unarmed African Americans are 5 times more likely to be shot and killed by police than white Americans. That's according to an ongoing study by the Washington Post. The study found that while white people make up about 62% of the U.S. population, they account for only 49% of people killed by officers. But African Americans, who make up only 13% of the population, account for 24% of those killed by police. That's double our total population. We now turn to our guest. And before we get into any discussion, I think it was so apropos that we were led into this discussion by Marvin Gaye from his album Back in the Day, What's Going On. As I said, before we get into this discussion, what I want to do and have for folks in the control room to do is to play the tape of Mr. Jeffries, who was accosted by Bladensburg, Maryland police officers on January the 17th, 2016. We want to play that and we'll come back and talk about it.
For a police officer.
I was trying to find somewhere to park, sir.
Put your hands on the steering wheel.
Can you put your gun away, sir?
Put your hands on the steering wheel.
Bro, I'm at work right now.
You're at work right now?
Yes.
I'm telling you, you're for a police officer.
I tried to pull over
for almost a quarter mile.
Yo, fam. I turned
into... Put your phone down. Give me your license and registration, sir.
This is crazy.
Put your phone down. Give me your license.
I'm putting my phone down.
Put your phone down.
My phone's not even in...
Give me your license registration.
Put my phone not even in my hand.
Pull down your window.
My window's down right now.
Pull down your window.
Man, I'm getting my license for you.
Pull down your
my
window.
My window is down.
Two ways. It's gonna go bad to real bad.
What's bad?
Pull down your window.
Sir, here you go.
Pull down your window now.
Sir, for what?
Pull down your window for my safety and your safety. Pull down your window.
My window's down.
I'm about to pull you out the car, man. Pull out your window.
For what?
Pull down your window.
Sir, you about to kill me right now?
Pull down your window.
Sir, here you go. My window's
registration
down.
Registration as well.
I don't have my
registration.
I don't have it.
Small offense.
I don't have it.
Give me your registration.
I don't have it.
All right, step out the vehicle for me.
Sir, do I have to, what do I have
step
to
step out the car.
Sir, I actually am afraid right now.
You're
I don't
afraid?
Yes.
Step out the car. I'm gonna pull you out the car. Step
for
out
what?
The car.
You gonna pull me out the car
step
for
out
what?
Out the car.
Sir, what did I do?
Step out the car. Dude, I'm telling you, this is gonna go bad.
Dude,
step out the car.
I'm at work right now. I have a pizza in the back seat.
I don't care. Step out the
what
car.
What do you mean you don't care?
Step out the car. Open the door.
Sir, I'm not doing anything wrong.
Dude, open the door. You failed to stop. Open the door.
I turned right here.
Open the door now.
Sir, we were on
the
highway.
Open the door.
Sir, I'm not going to move out
the
car.
I'm telling you, get out the car, dude.
You're pulling a gun on me?
Get out the car. Get out the car.
Sir, can you call
get
for backup?
Get out the car. I got backup.
Sir,
get out the car,
can you
dude.
Call for backup?
Dude, get out the
I
car.
I haven't done anything wrong.
Get out
wrong.
The car.
Hey, sir, get out the car.
Why are y'all doing this to me?
Get out
sir,
the car.
You're
no.
reaching in my car.
Get out the car.
You're trying why?
Get out
what
the
is
car,
going
dude.
On here?
Get out the car.
Sir, what are you doing?
Get out the car.
Sir,
get out the car.
Stop rolling the window up.
What am I? Can you
stop
tell me what I've
roll
done?
Roll the window down.
Can you tell me what I've done?
Roll the window down.
Can you tell me what I've done?
We're gonna let you know, but we already told you
sir,
to get out the car.
But can you
get
tell me? I'm at. Hold up.
Get out the car.
That is powerful and it is riveting. And as I heard just recently, Mr. Jeffries, you have not watched this video.
That's my first time watching it right there since. I think probably the February when we first put the video out, I watched it at like a some kind of book signing or something I was at, and that's the I haven't watched it. I can't watch it.
We're now 6 months later.
Yeah.
Why is it that you've never watched it?
I relive it enough in my head. I don't want to relive it anymore. Watching it, I can hear it. I can see the gun coming through the light. When he, my side mirror, I can see that pistol coming through. I don't want to keep reliving that, especially while nothing has been done about it.
You know? I want to turn to your mom. Thank you for joining us.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Tell us, let me say this. I often speak to mothers mm-hmm. who have younger sons, primarily 16, 17-year-olds, and that is a segment of our community, the young mothers, fathers, mm-hmm. who have children that are coming into their teenage years and becoming young adults, and they're amongst many of them is morbid fear.
Yeah.
Can you please share with us your thoughts and feelings from when you first saw this video and when you had your first discussion with Christopher about it?
So this is the first time I've seen it as well, because I can't watch it either. My heart's racing right now, and it's still unbelievable that that's what happened. I couldn't even take in what I was watching. I couldn't even understand what I was seeing. It was hard to even imagine that this is, you know, what was happening. And it's, you know, I'm saying, is that really a gun? Could this be a gun at my son who's delivering pizzas? You know, and then it was feelings of guilt. Why is he delivering pizzas? You know, he's been in college, he's making money, he's trying to go back. It's my fault. I shouldn't have made him work, which is the right thing to do, of course, but guilt and just confusion. And then I'm saying, you know, I've taught him to be respectful and ask questions. And, you know, and then I'm thinking, well, he had a BMW, but I bought him that car because he did well in school. And I said, if you do well, I'll get you a car. But it's not a new one. I'm like, and I let it grow his hair. So I'm like, what did he do? And it was just a feeling of just so much guilt personally. Like, what could I have done different that wouldn't have put him in that situation? But he didn't, there's nothing I could have changed, you know? And it's just, it's scary. Tried to do everything right.
We have with us Tamara Meekins, who's from the Attorney General's Office for the District of Columbia. You were a law professor.
Yes.
You just saw the video, you had seen it before, you heard what Christopher just described and what his mother just described. Mm-hmm. As sort of a legal academician, and now a practicing attorney in the D.C. office, what's your reaction to, one, the video, and what is obviously the trauma that is expressed here?
Well, I mean, my first reaction to it, and I watched it again today, and my first reaction to it is that I was afraid for him. I was afraid for him. I felt his fear in the video. I could see how it was such a tense situation. And as well, I admired that he was able to be calm and to try to ask questions in a way that, you know, expressed what he was feeling at the time, but that wasn't so out there that it would provoke or potentially get a response from the officer. I am so happy that nothing happened to him. But I think that when we all see those kinds of videos, the first thing that comes to mind is that you see the tension there. You see the fear this young man had. And I can't help but to think that I wished that both sides were being as calm and trying to de-escalate that situation as much as they could, right? Mm-hmm. Because I do think that Mr. Jeffries was trying to de-escalate it. He had his hands up, he was asking questions, he wasn't raising his voice, and I am really happy that nothing happened to him. But I do, one of the things that comes to my mind as a lawyer is that I want to see that kind of de-escalation on both sides, and particularly on the side of the officer, to actually try to de-escalate.
We tried unsuccessfully to get the Bladensburg Police Department to send a representative, whether it was going to be the arresting officer, the chief of police, or whoever it might be. And we tried to get several other representatives from surrounding organizations of the Fraternal Order of Police. They were not able to make it for one reason or the other. So I put this to you because I suspect, had we gotten an advocate for the police, for the officers, mm-hmm. the officers would say something like, you should have fully complied and not argued at all. I want to ask what your reply would be to that, if I'm right. And I also want to then go to Attorney Gordon to ask him.
I think that's a really hard question, because what you have is a situation where the natural response is to ask questions. And we try to teach young people to be assertive, to stand up for themselves, to know their rights, to assert their rights. But at the same time, now we have to try to say to them, but you have to maybe not assert your rights in some situations because of the danger. So I think it's just really a hard situation. And I would suspect as well that the advocate for the police officer or a police officer official would say as well, talk about their feelings, their feeling of danger in that particular type of situation as well too.
What an incredible tightrope to walk. The tightrope yes. of, one, maintaining your dignity and asserting your rights, juxtaposed against, I don't want to die. That's a that's a perilous, tattered tightrope.
I call it the Hobson's choice.
The Hobson's choice. Tell us what you mean.
Well, there's, you know, you're danged if you do and you're danged if you don't. When I look at this video, I get angry.
Still.
I mean, I came in here in a jovial mood and I watched that video and it changed my mood altogether. Because there's no reason why this young man should be subjected to that type of treatment for a traffic stop, where the gun is immediately pulled out and trained on his head. And then there are several commands barked at him within 10 seconds. And remarkably, he complied with all of them, except for the registration, because you know what? He's not going to reach over into his glove compartment and pull out his registration when you got a maniac with a gun trained on your forehead telling you to do several different things within 10 seconds.
Can I ask him your mindset at that point when you didn't get the registration? Was that, were you thinking, I better not do that because I might get blown away?
Yeah, I made that decision before he asked for the registration. I made the decision to not reach for anything.
Was the registration there?
Yeah, it was in my glove compartment.
We knew he had the registration
there. Yeah, it's in my
there.
Glove compartment yes. in the manual book where, like, I thought most people keep the registration and stuff.
Right.
But when the gun, That was the opening act. The gun was the first thing I saw. I saw the gun before I saw the officer.
Right.
So I made up my mind. People joke about it, but yeah. say, don't reach for
yeah.
nothing.
Yeah.
But in my mind, I said, so when he asked, that's why immediately I said, I don't have it.
Yeah.
Because I didn't even want to say, it's in my glove box. And he says, well, okay, get it. Bang.
Yeah.
Because, oh, he was reaching.
Yeah.
Right.
So, yeah, I went in my pocket because he was right there with the flashlight. And I figured, I mean, you could see I didn't have a gun, or you saw right. I had my camera, you saw my hands
right.
when you asked for but I wasn't going to reach for anything.
Right.
I mean, I wasn't going to reach, I made my mind up to not reach for anything mm-hmm. and deal with what I thought would just be a $50 fine.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Because he still hadn't told me why he pulled me over right. at that point.
Right.
So I figured he was on a power trip, I'll take the registration thing and, yeah. but
yeah.
if I give you my information, you'll see the information and I can verify the information to you.
Right.
And he had access to his registration to find out who the car belonged
yeah,
to.
Sure.
And he drives for a living. So yeah. he's got his driver's license and his registration. That's part of his job, to be out on the road in his vehicle.
Mm-hmm.
So he has all these things available to him. But under circumstances such as this, it wasn't worth the risk. I mean, this was a life or death situation. And people are quick to criticize what he could have done and should have done, but
yeah.
no one's ever been under the same situation as yeah. Mr. Jeffries in this particular case,
yeah.
where you have a gun trained on you and you're asked to show your hands, he shows his hand. You're asked to provide your driver's license, I provide my driver's license. You know, you ask to roll down your window, he rolls down the window. He
sure.
did everything yeah. this officer told him to do, and he was still subjected to this pistol trained on his forehead. So I think, again, I commend him for the
yeah.
way he handled
so
the situation.
So let me ask you, Once you got involved with the case, mm-hmm. have you been in do you have, as the attorney representing him, mm-hmm. do you have direct communication with the police department whose officer handled the case, handled the matter this way?
No. Quite frankly, once you've been doing this as long as I have, you're not going to get anything by trying to talk to the police officer about just having them dismiss the charges. The charges would have left the police department and gone to the state's attorney's office. So it was under the state's attorney's review. Now, communication with the state, yeah, we've had plenty of communication. In fact, that's how we...
When I ask that question, what I'm trying to find out mm-hmm. is whether or not there was ever an explanation given as to why that behavior took place.
No. There's a police report that, as you know, that's generated, and we can kind of glean from there. But this guy, no. In fact, I don't even think he didn't even mention in his police report that he pulled out his service revolver.
I was going to ask you.
He didn't mention it at all.
Obviously, you've examined, right. You know, with a fine-tooth comb, the right. police report.
Right.
What did it say?
It basically said that he accused my client of making a right-hand turn when unsafe
left
lane,
turn.
Unsafe left turn. When my client actually had made a right
turn. There's no
turn.
Lefts on my
there's
route.
There's no right. There's no left.
Crazy.
No right. But anyway. And so he claimed that he followed him for less than a quarter of a mile, which is no distance at all.
Right.
And that he claimed that my client refused to pull over. But on that particular strip of Kenilworth Avenue, there are no shoulders.
Right.
There are no shoulders. He wanted them to pull into some nondescript closed business. And he opted to pull under the street lights on between Kenilworth and Lloyd, which was the first intersection off of the exit that he had pulled onto.
Right.
So he pulled over to this safe place under the street light, and that's the behavior that he had to suffer.
Are you able to tell us what happened once the video went away? Are you able to share that?
I can share that.
Share that.
They extracted him from the vehicle. Officer Ayub, that is Muhir Ayub, placed him into his vehicle and commenced a beating on him. And then they ultimately took him to the police station and then to Upper Marlboro.
Commenced a beating on him?
Yes.
How?
Physically punching him in his chest area.
Can I speak? I got you. So what the officer was trying to do, or what the officer was trying to retrieve from me was my cell phone. And he was making that clear.
Right.
When they took me down, I put it in my back pocket. So when I sat down in the car, it's under my butt. He wanted that cell phone. He wanted that video. And he did what he thought he needed to do to retrieve it from me.
But you were in handcuffs.
Yes, I was in handcuffs. I made it difficult, obviously. I'm sitting on it.
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
All right, so what were the charges?
Well, he had a battery of charges. There were about 10. I can't even remember them all, but I do remember resisting arrest, assault on an officer, a battery of traffic citations, and I think
looting.
I'm sorry?
Looting.
Oh, fleeing and eluding, and some things of that nature.
Okay, so that happened on January the 17th. That was about what time?
That was at 11:07.
And the driving that you were doing, you said, I have a pizza in the back.
The pizza was still there when I picked
the car. The car smelled like pizza.
Yeah. And were you delivering a pizza to someone?
And I was one block away. So I was turned on Lloyd. The next block was my delivery point. That person.
So this happened late at night. It's 11 o'clock. So when did Mom find out about even that there was some trouble?
It wasn't until the next morning, because, I mean, he's 20 some years old. He doesn't call me every night.
Well, they didn't let me get a call for about 12 hours though. I didn't talk to anyone.
So they held you.
So no one knew.
My
grandmother, my girlfriend, no one knew about it. For about 12 hours, I was in a cell at Bladensburg. I was in a cell at Bladensburg for about 6 or 7 hours, and that was just solitary. That was just like an alienated room with the bars and the toilet. And then they moved me to Upper Marlboro. When I got to Upper Marlboro, maybe about 4 hours, they let people make calls, and that's when I called my grandmother, I think.
Yeah, I think I happened to be out of town, and it was just a number of calls, and I can remember we finally spoke, and it was unbelievable. It was, my son was not the same. And all I wanted to do, it was for work, was to get home. Because you can hear, you know.
Yeah.
You know when they've been changed. You know when someone's violated your child.
Yeah. Let me ask, your father is here. Your father is here in the audience.
Mm-hmm.
What was his reaction?
He wanted to get home. He was with me. He wanted to get home. It's unbelievable. You want to, it's painful. You want to go talk. You know, it's funny, like what you said. You wanted an explanation. You want to be rational. Why did you do this to my child? What did he do to deserve this? Okay, so maybe you thought something was going wrong, but once you realized he had a pizza, how come you couldn't pull back? You know, we're rational people. You know, I happen to do a job where we work and we try and de-escalate. I wanted to talk to the guy. Why would you do this? Do you know what you've done?
Did you, as the parent, ever get any kind of explanation from the folks at Bladensburg?
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. I mean, I've been in court. I've seen the gentleman, and I've seen the smirks, mm-hmm. and I've seen the attitude, and I'm amazed mm-hmm. because I prayed a lot about this.
He thinks somebody has done him wrong,
and he rolls his eyes at me after putting a gun to my son's head, and he's angry, which amazes me.
You know, I have no doubt that in our viewing audience, there are a multitude of parents
yeah.
and loved ones who identify with your fear. I'm talking about specifically African-American
yeah.
mothers. We have a film clip that gives the experience of a white woman who was rearing a black son. I want our viewing audience to take a look at that because I think it really makes an impact.
We never talked about race growing up. I just don't think that was ever a conversation.
I thought that love would conquer all and skin color really didn't matter. I had to learn the really hard way when they almost killed you.
Yeah. I was 19 years old. I had picked up a friend and I noticed that we had red and blue lights behind us. We were being pulled over. The officer explained I had made an illegal left turn and to step out of the car. So I get out of the car first. He pats me down. And then he goes around to the passenger side and pulls my friend Addison out of the car.
Addison is white.
Yeah, Addison is white. And he had some weed in his coat pocket. So he gets placed in handcuffs. I figure that everything's okay. I'm not in handcuffs. I've already been patted down. Plus, there's three officers on the scene. And I had never had a negative interaction with police in my life. So I ask them, can I please see a warrant before you continue the search? And they grabbed me and began to hit me in the face. I could hear Addison in the background yelling, stop, leave him alone. I was hit several times, and I remember gasping for air and spitting and blood flying across the grass. And then I hear an officer shout out, he's reaching for a gun. I immediately started yelling, no, I'm not. I'm not reaching for anything. And I remember an officer say, if he doesn't calm down, we're going to have to shoot him. I could feel the gun pressed to my head. I expected to be shot, and at that point, I lost consciousness. I woke up to a multitude of officers just standing around me laughing. One officer was like, where's that warrant now, you fucking nigger? It took 45 stitches to close up the lacerations in my face alone. How did it feel when you finally saw me?
All I remember is involuntarily screaming.
That was the first time I had cried the entire time I had been in there. And it wasn't my injuries that hurt. It was just seeing how it devastated you.
My whole worldview changed that night.
Yeah. For me, it was the point of awakening to how the rest of the world is going to look at you. I was just another black face in the streets. And I was almost another dead black male.
This is a white lady who expressed that changed my whole worldview. I don't want to give you an impossible question, but I might ask it anyway. There are so many that are expressing the idea that Black Lives Matter is a terrorist hate group. Again, I come to you as the academician. What do you, how would you communicate to the white community who happen to be watching these things and coming up with opinions that call a Black Lives Matter group a terrorist group that don't seem to understand the dynamic, the fear, and the trauma that Black Americans are feeling as a result of their relationship with police?
Well, let me just say that is a little bit of an impossible question, but I'll take a stab at it. I think that the Black Lives Matter movement is a call to not just white Americans, to Black Americans, to Americans of all races, to finally say to the country and to the people that there, we have recognized that for many years, under color of law, Black lives have not mattered, right? It's an important statement to make as a clarion call for the movement that Black lives do matter. And I shudder whenever I hear the whole notion that Black Lives Matter is a terrorist group, because it certainly hasn't started as a terrorist group. It is not poised to be any kind of terrorist group. What the Black Lives Matter group is doing is bringing attention to this issue that has been with us for years, hundreds of years, right? So from slavery through Reconstruction, through the Civil Rights Movement, we've seen these same things where we have these interactions with police officers that have instilled in our culture this thought that Black lives do not matter. And so this clarion call, naming this group Black Lives Matter and making it a part of our cultural language now, and making sure that people understand that they do have a voice and that they can go out into the street, they can protest, they can stand in solidarity with people like Mr. Jeffries as well, is important for our country. It's just important for especially young people to know, and I might add that it has allowed a number of younger folks, and I'm not in that group anymore, right, but it's allowed a lot of young folks to get a sense of what that shared cultural experience has been. And I think it also has shown to white Americans, especially with the advent of social media, that these things are happening. They're happening often, and they have happened over the course of many years, and they have been ignored. And so now is a time that we cannot ignore. Black lives do matter.
I think that some of this came about out of frustration, anger, trauma, and the rest, out of Tamir Rice getting shot, out of Trayvon Martin and Eric Garner, and there not being penalties that right. those who perpetrated those acts right. had to face. Right. There was a raging debate about the prosecutorial process, about the grand jury process. Mm-hmm. Some of those, you know, when one makes that comment, you know, a prosecutor, district attorney, can indict a ham sandwich before a grand jury. But in one of them, there was in the Michael Brown case, no indictment. Mm-hmm. Can you explain for us sort of 101 that process from an act taking place like that mm-hmm. to an eventual outcome, whether it is positive or negative, and tell us a little bit about the grand jury. We hear that word and it's like the boogeyman.
Okay. All right. Well, the grand jury is just a group of, in most states, 23 people that are called to grand jury service. And a grand jury is different from a trial jury, which we call a petit jury. Mm-hmm. It's a smaller number. They listen to evidence at a trial. But a grand jury is, in essence, an investigative tool. So it has its roots in the Constitution, but states use it in different ways. For example, here in the District of Columbia, every felony charge has to go to a grand jury. So at a grand jury, the grand jurors sit, they've been called to service much like regular jurors, and they sit for an extended period of time and they hear the evidence that is part of the initial investigation of a case. It is a process whereby prosecutors present the evidence to the grand jurors from the prosecutorial point of view, because the grand jury's charge is to see if the prosecutors have enough evidence to bring or continue a case through the court system, mm-hmm. all right? It's also part of our adversarial system, because what we believe is that a charge or a set of evidence against a person needs to be tested to some degree in these very serious cases. So prosecutors will call witnesses. Hearsay is admissible at the grand jury process, and the grand jury is looking at to determine if there is enough evidence to a standard of probable cause to believe that a particular defendant or person committed a charge. The grand jury votes on specific charges. Now, of course, the grand jurors are general people like you and me, yeah. right? And other people in the community, and they don't often have a lot of legal knowledge. And because it's not a situation where you have a judge or you have a defense attorney, the prosecutor then gets to instruct the jury or tell those grand jurors what the law is. Mm-hmm. And so the prosecutors don't have to prove their case to a standard of beyond a reasonable doubt. Mm-hmm. They just have to show that there is sufficient evidence to a standard of probable cause that that particular person committed these particular crimes. If the grand jurors believe that that evidence, that standard of evidence has been shown, then they will vote out what's called a true bill, mm-hmm. Which just means these are the particular charges that this particular defendant is going to face in court. Then the court process, the adversarial process, begins, because then that person is called into court. They hear the charges against them. They enter their plea of guilty or not guilty. And then the process continues on. Mm-hmm. So the grand jury is just, in essence, an investigatory body. But they are hearing evidence just from one side, mm-hmm. not fully contested evidence.
Yeah, let me go to you as a defense attorney. As a defense attorney
right.
who seems to have earned the moniker, the warrior lawyer.
That's right.
Okay, so just hearing that explanation, I think I saw at the corner of my eye, you were nodding.
Yes.
But as a defense attorney, one, I want to ask you how you feel about that process, one, and two, what are your feelings about appointed prosecutors who work day in and day out with police officers being the ones that then have oversight and prosecutorial decision making over the very officers that they often work with?
So the first question was, how do I feel about it,
I think?
Well, as far as the grand jury is concerned, I prefer, in Maryland, we have what's called a preliminary hearing, which serves the same purpose as the grand jury, except for the fact that we get a chance to cross-examine the state's evidence and develop a record that we can go get and use for later purposes to perhaps impeach a particular witness if they say one thing before the preliminary hearing, which is a public and open hearing, mm-hmm. and say something different on the stand at trial. So we like preliminary hearings.
Okay, so that's and public and open, whereas as grand jury is secret.
Secret. Mm-hmm. We're not even allowed in there.
Uh-huh.
And the prosecutor controls all the evidence that goes into the grand jury. So if they want to put forth evidence that prevents them from getting the true bill, they can put forth that additional evidence. And in these police cases, remarkably, you will see a defendant, someone who's charged with the crime, willingly allowing, willingly wanting to speak to the grand jury to explain his side of the case. I think we saw that in Eric Garner, if I'm not mistaken. And so he also offers evidence, and we definitely saw it in the Michael Brown case. He offers evidence to support his point of view. And in the Michael Brown case, I just think that the grand jury now has been manipulated and misused by those prosecutors who do not want to prosecute police officers, because what they will do is they will present to the grand jury a bunch of conflicting information. They say, well, we're going to get all the information to the grand jury. But that's not how it normally works. They only give one side of the information to the grand jury normally. But when it's a police officer, every person who said something different from the next person, they'll interview like hundreds and hundreds of people looking for inconsistent statements to support reasonable doubts, to support the inability to secure an indictment, and put all that mush in front of a grand jury. It's not streamlined, one side of the story, let me know what you think. It's, we're giving you everything. Here, you look at all this, look at all these inconsistent statements. We brought these people in here so you can hear from them. You heard what so-and-so said about this guy, and yes, that's inconsistent with what we thought actually happened, you know, and they have all that information, then they make a decision. So a prosecutor knows how to manipulate a grand jury, just like they say we can indict a ham sandwich. They absolutely can. I mean, most grand juries basically rubber stamp the prosecution's version of the case. Now, they will argue and debate that with me, but basically that's how it goes, because they control what goes in. If you control what's going in, you control what comes out.
In Mr. Jeffrey's case, on Monday, the family got the good news that all charges were dismissed.
Well, we made it happen.
Okay, and that's what I wanted to ask. Yes. The state's attorney for Prince George's County's office were the ones that said, we don't think that there is anything here that will allow these charges to stand. We're dismissing all of them. Now, so did you, as the warrior lawyer, have any impact on that process? Did you do any lawyering that help that result come about?
Absolutely. We produced not only the video that you saw on television, but we produced our own video of us driving the route that Mr. Jeffries drove on the evening in question, and so that, and we showed on the speedometer what a quarter of a mile looked like, how short of a distance it was, and how promptly he pulled over at the sign of these blue and red lights flashing behind him. We had multiple conversations, and we told them we weren't given an inch. I mean, this was something, you bring that case that you saw in that video in Prince George's County, it ain't gonna happen. Mm-hmm. It's not gonna happen. I knew it, and they knew it. And actually, it was good that we had a very reasonable prosecutor, and his supervisor, who they ran it past, was also equally as reasonable. They understood where we were coming from. They wanted us to take some traffic citations. And I said, no. I said, well, maybe I would consider the registration citation, but I'd have to talk to my client about it. But I'm not really interested. I'm not really thinking that that's what we're going to do either. So he said, okay, just take it to your client, see what you said. So I talked to my client about it, and we conversed about it. And I was like, you know what? They're offering the failure to produce registration, but I think that this case needs to be dismissed altogether. And my client was in agreement with me. He felt as though it was, because the only reason why he didn't produce his registration was because he was scared to death.
Right.
So I don't think that's specific intent not to comply. I mean, he had to make a choice.
Yeah.
Am I going to live?
Sure.
Or am I going to reach for this registration and not knowing what could possibly happen to me? So I conveyed those arguments to the prosecutor, and after some back and forth, they eventually relented on the day of trial.
Did you know before that was going to be the decision? I'm just curious as to how
I didn't care what they thought, because I knew what I was going to do. And that's really, and I'm not trying to chest beat and make it seem like I'm super duper attorney.
Sure.
But this one touched me.
Yeah.
And I think I have a responsibility to protect our people when things like this occur. So I didn't care what they thought. If my client had the risk tolerance to go through with it, if he felt as strongly about it as I did, and he could tolerate a trial, and I kind of let him know what the worst case scenarios would be, and it was worth the risk anyway, but I just felt as though so strongly that this case deserved nothing but a complete dismissal, and I wasn't going to relent. At the end of the day, they say, well, you know what? we're going to try the registration case. If you don't, you know, we're not going to drop it right now. We're going to try it. I said, well, set it up. We'll try it. Because
there was horse trading. There was negotiation.
Yeah, there was negotiation. Posturing. He's like, look, we'll dismiss everything else. Because the prosecutor was reasonable. He said, I just want something out of it. I said, I can't give it to you. Yeah. I said, so if we get, if you dismiss everything else and you want to leave the registration, we're not going to leave it on the table. You're going to have to fight for that. Yeah. You're going to have to fight for everything you get.
Let's go back to the gentleman who had the gun in his face for some extended period of time, and as you say, were then beaten on. You said earlier that you didn't want to see it because you had seen it in your mind and you have experienced it. Tell us what that feels like.
It's definitely life-changing. Because if you think about life, we always think about you have so much to live for, living, you're living, you're gonna grow old, you're gonna, life is such a long thing, a long idea to us. But when you have a situation where that can be taken away from you in literally a split second or a blink of an eye, I thought, it doesn't sound dramatic. I thought I was gonna die. I didn't feel safe until I was out of his custody, until I got to Upper Marlboro, because you see it over and over again. He doesn't need a reason. So you're thinking about everything. You're thinking about, I'm thinking about my mom, I'm thinking about my girlfriend, I'm thinking about my family, I'm thinking about school. Everything is going through your mind. They say your life flashes before your eyes.
Mm-hmm. You're thinking about all that because you're thinking there's a real possibility that you might not live.
Yes, and when I say I'm thinking about it, I mean it's hard to explain. It's a fear that gets inside of your chest that feels like this is it. Yeah. When I'm on that ground and my face is on the street, I felt like Oscar Grant had to feel the exact same way before they pulled the trigger in his back. Because you don't your face is in that ground and he's acting frantic and manic and disgruntled. I'm just waiting for the gun to go off.
Oh my God.
Yeah. And so that until I was out of his custody, when I got to the his station department and I'm in there, I thought about Sandra Bland because there's nobody in that station. There wasn't a deputy, there wasn't another. It was dark. It looked like something out of a horror movie. And he put me in there and he belittled me, talked to me like this is normal for you. You know what to do. Give me your shoes. Do this, do that. And it's just like, if I say anything wrong, I mean, in the video, I'm saying, yes, sir. By the time I got to jail, I didn't even want to say anything because I just don't want him to say, I remember he's trying to take my cuffs off and he's like, I'll tase your ass if you move. And I'm like, dude, you know I don't want to do anything. You can't tell, at this point, I have no priors, I have nothing, a pizza. So when I say I'm thinking about all those things, it's like, man, I didn't get to say bye to any of those things. So death is real. And when you get on the, right on the borderline of like being Philando Castile, if I reach and he decides that I was reaching for something, I'm in that video on Facebook in Minnesota. It's that scary.
And Mom,
yeah.
how do you feel hearing that?
It's heartbreaking. You know, I still believe in all the good in this country, and you try and raise your kids so they never have to experience that. I don't know what can a parent do to prepare themselves for how his life is forever changed. So despite all you try and do up to this age, that one incident can forever change his life. And he's never going to be the same.
It did.
Yeah. And I'm blessed. I mean, but I know he's fearful every day. But I'm blessed that he's still here.
Are you fearful every day?
It's not the same. My life isn't the same. I don't.
How would you describe the difference?
Well, when you haven't done anything wrong, like if you know you've done something wrong, you kind of got like, man, if I get caught with this, I might. When you haven't, you literally are delivering a pizza. That sounds like so corny. You literally have a hot pizza and some wings in your back seat. Like if I have a broken tail light, my tail light out. Well, if I get stopped for this, is this it? If I see I was at a restaurant, I saw a group of police officers. They were minding their business. I was minding mine. I just couldn't be in there with them, just because I didn't know if I looked at them wrong. If I, I didn't know what I could possibly do to incite something. And that's every day. Every
single day. It's so unfair because of this one guy. You know, it's just so unfair that somebody can take that away from all that we've tried to do, all that we do for our sons. One person can come in and take that away.
Tomorrow, again, you're within the Attorney General's Office for the District of Columbia, what they're talking about is quintessential intimidation. How do police departments change their training, their behavior, in a way that takes that away? Because what that is that kind of bestowing of fear and intimidation. First of all, it was outwardly practiced many years ago. It's probably, to some extent, been practiced throughout history up until now. Part of when I see these videos, part of my response has been knowing that some of these kind of things happened when there wasn't the video.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So the third time I'm going to call you an academician. What does the academician say to police departments to create a better policing process and a better relationship with the minority community?
Well, I think it has to be a kind of multi-pronged approach to it. So first of all, I think police officers and forces in general need to always have, at the beginning when police officers enter the force, all throughout, like constantly, cultural bias training, implicit bias training, sensitivity training, and they have to open the dialogue up with young men like Mr. Jeffries, with other community members, and be willing to listen, first of all, and to see the point of view, to see how their behavior, while it might seem to them like they're asserting their authority, like they're taking control of a situation, like they are protecting themselves, how that threat can engender complete mistrust that continues throughout and just spreads. And so I think police departments overall have to employ methods, practices throughout their departments that are going to focus on building relations with our communities of color, with those communities that have experienced these incidents of police brutality, police misconduct. They have to look at lower level conduct as well too, because when you see officer interaction with young folks on the street that is harassing, that is seen as disrespectful, that doesn't recognize their dignity, then that kind of engenders something bigger, a bigger response. So they have to look at it from the smallest interactions to the larger interactions as well. There needs to be additional training at the police academy. There needs to continue that training throughout. Policies and procedures need to be looked at as well to determine if we are sending the right message in the policies and procedures, and if the letter and terms of those policies and procedures allow for the de-escalation of situations like this one.
Should there be a cessation of writing tickets to raise money for jurisdictions?
Okay, well, there was an article in the paper just the other day about the number the amount of revenue that the cities are getting as
and
a
the
response
DC cameras.
To these tickets. I do think we need to take a holistic approach at that, right? Because there's a balancing that needs to take place between, you know, the number of interactions that you're going to have with people if that is your culture to write tickets at all costs because of the revenue benefit. Back in the 2012 or so, when New York was looking at the Floyd case, there were a lot of statistics that showed that, you know, those police stops, those interactions with motorists, they were done in a way, because they were allowed to just stop for no whatever reasons, and traffic infractions were one of them, we saw where there was a pattern of racial bias and racial profiling in those stops. Mm-hmm. I remember one statistic where it said that in Brooklyn, in an 8-block radius in Brooklyn, during the course of less than 4 years, 52,000 separate African Americans were stopped for traffic violations, right? And so we saw there that that kind of policing where you're focusing on those lower level offenses, where you're focusing on traffic citations, has a lot of negatives, one of them being that it looks very much like racial profiling is rampant. Yeah. And what we're seeing now is that those same types of practices can lead to these types of incidents. So I think jurisdictions have to look at generally they have to look at how are we going to balance the need to get this revenue and to make our streets safe yeah. with what it looks like to the community, which is this overuse of those traffic violations to stop.
Christopher, you described sort of the fear and the trauma and the impact of your experience. You did mention being in somewhere where there was a group of police officers. Mm-hmm. Are there those moments that you're just walking down the street or just doing, you know, brushing your teeth or something, and you feel that incident? Do you experience that?
After the incident first began, I tried to sleep because after I was in jail, I didn't sleep the entire time I was in there. I didn't want to eat, sleep, drink anything. So I just wanted to sleep. And my nightmares were so bad, and I was jumping in my sleep. It's like a nervous tick or something in my sleep, to the point where I don't really get much sleep anymore. I don't sleep. I mean, I sleep when the sun hits my window. When the sun comes through, I know that I need to at least try to get a couple hours of sleep. But no one wants that feeling. It's a feeling of as soon as I close my eyes, it's like you're doing something wrong while you're doing is laying in your bed. And so I don't get much sleep anymore. I don't look forward to the end of the day. I always want to keep things going because I know there's going to come a time where it's just me and that night. Yeah.
I don't want to get too personal, but have you sought or are you guys
yes.
seeking any help to
yes.
to get through that?
Yes, we're doing therapy in Lanham, Maryland, with Susan Richardson. Mm-hmm. We're doing what we have to do to just make sure that I'm okay mentally going forward. And, you know, hopefully over time that starts to knock down that wall of what's inside of my mind now. Yeah.
Attorney Gordon.
Yes.
This is obviously a big deal.
Absolutely.
I saw you make reference to this is not over.
Right.
What do you plan to do?
Oh, well, we plan to seek justice for Mr. Jeffries. I mean, he suffered an incredible wrong, and I think that justice needs to have its final say in this matter, so that's what we intend to do.
Do you care to try to describe what you think justice might look like?
Well, unfortunately, he can't have those moments back in his life, okay? So those moments are forever gone. What's been stolen from him, been robbed from him, will not come back anytime soon, if at all. And so we want a group of people to decide what justice looks like. And so we're pursuing that avenue.
And does that mean that you're going to file suit again?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
And who will you sue?
Oh, we will sue Officer Mahir Ayoub. And if we get into that lawsuit deep enough and we find some policies and practices of the Bladensburg Police Department, we will add them to the claim. But at this point in time, we're trained and focused on Officer IU.
Huh? Christopher, having been in the situation, we now have just a little over a minute left. Any parting words to other young men that you might have from your experience?
Honestly, I can't. I don't. What I will say is that I know how we can be we can feel like we have a right to voice those frustrations of what's going on right there. But I mean, as you see in the video, I didn't curse at him. I didn't call him out of his name. I know that a lot of my peers will feel the need to speak up, and that isn't worth it. You can de-escalate that situation, but at the same time, like, try to put yourself first.
Yeah.
Complying with the law is one thing, but live.
Yeah.
Get out of that situation. If they, you know, whatever they decide to do, people say, oh, you should have complied, you should have done this, charges get dropped. He should have done this, he should have done that. I lived.
Yeah.
I lived. And before I went in that courtroom, I prayed. I prayed for the officer. I prayed that God would have mercy on him.
Yeah.
Because I know that we're not going to have mercy on him.
Yeah.
But that man's not right. That man.
From a legal point of view.
Yeah.
No, yeah. I understand. You know, and I,
this is powerful, and it certainly speaks to a much bigger issue. Folks, tomorrow, WHUT will continue this discussion about the chasm between the African-American community and law enforcement with a special 24-hour presentation of the short film #American. It is a powerful and surprising story of a white police officer working in a black neighborhood. You can start watching it at 7 p.m. tomorrow in a 24-hour rotation. It is powerful. That wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. Goodbye, and God bless. The struggle continues.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.